Okay, could I ask those leaving the public gallery to please do so as quickly and as quietly as possible? The next item of business is a member's business debate on motion 6414 in the name of Michelle Thompson on Small Business Saturday 2022. The debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I'd invite members to press the request to speak buttons now or as soon as possible, and invite Michelle Thompson to open the debate for around 7 minutes. Ms. Thompson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm honoured to open this debate celebrating Small Business Saturday, and I encourage everyone to support their local small businesses. They are the heartbeat of our local communities. The Small Business Saturday Initiative is a grassroots campaign. It's in its 10th year and is sponsored in its efforts by American Express. I'm sure, like me, most MSPs will be meeting local small business owners and employees on Saturday. We should tell them. We will be increasing our efforts to give them a voice and support their endeavours in the coming year. I'll come to acknowledge their importance in economic and employment terms later in this speech, but I want to start by acknowledging their social impact. Indeed, before the term was invented, many small businesses have been contributing hugely to the well-being of society in general and local communities in particular, whether supporting local charities, providing general advice to customers, or just being that friendly presence willing to listen to those in need. The human face of small businesses provide incalculable support in local communities. As a member of the Economy and Fair Work Committee, I was pleased to see our committee report into town centres launched this week. Put bluntly, most town centres in Scotland would quickly die without the active presence of local small businesses. But far too often, they're placed at a huge economic disadvantage in comparison with large businesses. I want to emphasise another point often missed. While some large global businesses with a Scottish presence can move their money around, taking advantage of tax havens, local small businesses typically pay their taxes. It means the proportion of income tax paid in taxes is often much greater for SMEs than for many global businesses. This places them at an added trading disadvantage. And like many, I'm sure, taking part in this debate, we all know of some small businesses that have struggled in recent years affected by the pandemic, and where the owners have been taking out from their business significantly less than the minimum wage, yet they continue. In terms of the wider economy, some small businesses are part of a much larger critical supply chain. We often forget the breadth of small businesses. They span a huge variety of activities, such as operating taxi services, providing private nursery and childcare services, being the local sparky and plumber, working their croft, providing specialist research services, being the local lawyer, the local accountant, and often making better and cheaper coffee than the big chains that don't pay their taxes. The list goes on. While small businesses often serve other large businesses, too often this is not reciprocated. Many small businesses face late payments from larger businesses and sometimes find it difficult to access affordable loans from banks to invest in their business. Too often, the relatively small sums they need access to are just not on the radar of lending houses. Despite this, SMEs are critical to the economy. As the Spice briefing entitled Scotland's Business-Based Facts and Figures has indicated, sole proprietors, owner-manager or employee-director companies accounted for 70% of the 364,310 private sector enterprises in Scotland in 2020. They employ thousands of people in every constituency in the land, and often they are long-serving in local communities, in some cases spanning generations of family-run businesses. Small businesses have also been critical in helping communities cope with the many privations created by the COVID-19 pandemic. Simple things, such as delivering local groceries to old-age pensioners and, at the same time, checking to ensure they are alive and well, have more than an economic impact. We all face a cost of living crisis, and this is no less true of small businesses than it is of individuals. Some people seem to imagine business has it easy in comparison to individuals. Not true. Inflation is a common and deadly enemy. We have both a cost of living crisis and a cost of doing business crisis affected by the same enemy. Some other specialist small businesses are trying to support our economy by trading internationally, but finding things have been made immeasurably more difficult because of Brexit and the barriers erected to trading in Europe. The international reach of many small businesses have been critical in keeping open our window to the world. We need to ensure our trading policies reflect the realities being faced by small business. They don't have the luxury of saying Brexit's behind us. It isn't for them. They're living through the catastrophe that is Brexit to this very day and into the future. So as parliamentarians, we always need to do more to support our SMEs and recognise their worth in our constituencies. Freudian slip. We need to listen more to their problems and act to support them in difficult times. I'm very much looking forward to hearing the contribution from others, and I thank all the members who've signed my motion. As I close, let me do so by sending out all of our heartfelt thanks to the thousands of small businesses in my constituency of Falkirk East and across Scotland who are so critical to the economic and social life in our local communities. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms. Thompson. I now call Jamie Huckle-Johnson to be followed by Paul McLennan for around 4 minutes. Mr. Huckle-Johnson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I welcome this opportunity to speak in this debate on this weekend, Small Business Saturday. And I echo my thanks and the thanks of Michelle Thompson to all small businesses across the country, and I thank Michelle Thompson for bringing this important debate to the Chamber today. And I'd also like to applaud the work of the Small Business Saturday campaign and their efforts to encourage us to shop locally and to support our small businesses. This Saturday comes at an important time of year for Scottish retail. Falling between the now embedded Black Friday and Cyber Monday sales, this annual event, as mentioned in its 10th year, gives small businesses a chance to boost their revenue during the holiday shopping season. And it gives us all an opportunity to support our local communities. Small businesses are vital parts of Scotland's cities, towns and villages, from cafes to chemists and florists to fishmongers. They're the backbone of the Scottish economy, and it's right that we do everything we can to support their success. And this is particularly true in my own region of the Highlands and Islands, where smaller businesses predominate. In remote and rural areas, it can be a particular struggle for enterprises to thrive. The high cost of fuel and limited transport options are barriers for both small enterprises and their customers. And in island communities, some small businesses are hit both ways. Supplier costs are increasing at the same time as delivery costs to get finished products back to the mainland and beyond are going up. Many small businesses are struggling for recruitment, and this is particularly but not exclusively true in the hospitality and tourism sectors. And events like Small Business Saturday, as well as other initiatives, have also encouraged small businesses to embrace digital solutions to expand their customer base. At a time when traditional retail can be a particularly challenging environment, it's good to see help and support to diversify. And while this can be seen as simply a campaign to go down to our local high street, we must recognise that not all small businesses are on the street corner. Across our regions, we're seeing new businesses start up in garages, spare rooms and on kitchen tables, often harnessing the power of an online presence. And many shops are now finding an online angle to complement their physical presence. We all know local businesses that enhance our sense of place. And I'm looking forward to visiting the Evadale Bistro and Bakehouse in my home of Orkney this weekend. And they're a fantastic example of a small business which spans across both hospitality and tourism, as well as providing a vital local service for a small community many miles away from the island's main settlements. And it's not just the service that they provide to the public. I was in Cafe Gallo in Stockbridge recently, and this family-run cafe, run by Delita and her sons Oscar and Joe, as well as keeping other businesses refreshed, also support their local businesses and their business community by sourcing many of their products locally. And popping in, you often notice those other businesses coming in and those from other suppliers and locally dropping off their supplies, but also using the cafe's services too. And especially in rural communities, businesses are often not only about building a livelihood alone. They are about people. The closure of small businesses, and particularly on an island, can have a knock-on effect right across that community. And we must not forget that many small businesses are still suffering from the knock-on effects of the COVID crisis and now face the prospect of an economic downturn amid a cost of living crisis. Recovery can feel distant, and increases in the cost of living are going to have a broad impact. Understandably, people are going to search for lower prices, but we should always remember that the additional costs faced in delivering services locally and the important local role that businesses play. And it's also worth remembering, in the midst of a pandemic, the vital role that many small businesses performed, keeping communities supplied and services running. Deputy Presiding Officer, I have pointed to a number of challenges. Many of these were considered in the Economy and Fair Work Committee that I sit on in its report, as Michelle Thompson mentioned, and I certainly commend it as a body of work to the Chamber. But we should also consider the positives that small businesses create, the opportunities of entrepreneurship, and the ability to perform that social role contributing to our community. We must continue to support those setting out and starting up. This Saturday is Small Business Saturday, but it's not just about this Saturday. It's about every day of the week. And it's about reminding us that our local businesses depend on us just as much as we depend on them. I'm afraid I've finished.
Thank you, Mr. Hackle-Johnson. I can confirm I'm available for Evedale Pizza on Saturday if the offer comes in. Paul McLennan to be followed by Daniel Johnson again, around 4 minutes, Mr. McLennan.
Thank you, Deputy President Officers. Can I thank Michelle Thompson for bringing forward this motion today? Small Business Saturday, as she said, is in its 10th year in the UK, and this weekend, like many others, I'll be out visiting many small businesses in the constituency. Michelle also mentioned around about the 360,000 private sector businesses operating in Scotland, and she also mentioned about the figure as well, about 70% are other businesses with sole proprietors or partnerships. So we can see there's a scope to support and grow our small business sector much, much more. The Economy and Fair Work Committee have just published their inquiry into retail and town centres in Scotland, which I think is really a bit relevant to this debate. The committee welcomed the Scottish Government's policy refresh and renewed focus on Scotland's town centres and the retail sector. And they also welcomed the Scottish Government's retail strategy, which the Minister announced a few months ago, and obviously the establishment of the Retail Industry Leadership Group. As we know, retail is an extremely important sector for Scotland's economy. In particular, the independent retail sector is playing an increasingly important role, and many of Scotland's retailers are looking to diversify and embrace new channels for selling, and I'm going to touch on that just in a little second. The inquiry also stated there is a strong demand among Scotland's small retailers for more and better support to build their online presence and be able to take advantage of platforms and expertise that already exist. I've seen that in my own hometown in Dunbar. It's launched its Our Dunbar website with support from the Traders and Community Council, and that's going down real well and has seen increases in trade. The Scottish Government has committed £100 million to help business improve their digital skills, capacity and capability. It's also committed to support improved broadband capacity and mobile connectivity in towns and town centres to improve local digital platforms, and that's incredibly important. The committee also mentioned that it's vital to see a broader range of opportunities being made available to upskill, strengthen and future-proof the retail workforce. National and local government must do more to support that. Business gateways, I think, also are incredibly important in supporting businesses establish and grow, especially in the first year or two when they need a little bit of support. So we need to identify measures, both nationally and locally, to increase uptake and consider how business gateway can be expanded and improved in its offering. Scotland's towns are individual. I know there are six or seven main towns within my own constituency. They all have their distinct identities, their communities, their histories and their future. Every town, as I said, has its story, and communities can be and are motivated by the expression of that unique story to drive forward that change and improvement. We know that works where there's a common purpose and community drive to shape that town, and there's lessons, I think, to be learned from everybody in that regard. What is important is every town and its community is empowered to create a vision to focus on achieving that through a long-term town plan. And again, I know there are a few towns in my own constituency that are looking to do that and take advantage of that. To support that, we've got to remove barriers and try and support as best we can with appropriate advice. That's including financial support if it's available at all stages of development. The town centre's first principle in planning is key and will continue to be so going forward. And being a member of the Local Government Committee, we've been discussing that in NPF4 with the Minister on a number of occasions, and I think that's been welcomed broadly across the spectrum. Any new proposed out-of-town developments need to demonstrate town centre sites have been pursued and thoroughly evaluated. That development will have no adverse impact on town centres and will not compete with town centre provision. We welcome the Scottish Government's consultation on permitted development rights and intention to support the creation of a new general town centre use class. And again, that gives more flexibility, I think, to town centres to develop. We need to see more transparency of ownership of town centre property. I know we've all had issues when we've tried to identify some land or properties that are in town centres, which sit there for a number of years because we can't trace the owner, and that is a particular issue. Local authorities also have a range of powers to enable them to tackle derelict or dangerous buildings. And again, that was raised in discussions around about NPF4, but we need to encourage local authorities to do more around about that area. Presiding Officer, in conclusion, small businesses are the heart of our communities. We all need to do more to ensure that they thrive in our communities. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr McLean. I now call Daniel Johnston to be followed by Christine Graham around 4 minutes, Mr Johnston.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. And can I too thank Michelle Thompson for bringing forward this debate. It always is huge pleasure for me to speak in the debate on Small Business Saturday because, as most members will be aware, small business, especially small retail business, is very close to my heart. So close to my heart that I think my declaration of interest barely does it justice. But just for the avoidance of doubt, I am a director of a business with retail interests, although those are very residual. And indeed, you know, before coming into Parliament, I ran a small retail business in Edinburgh, which is why I know how important this is, because I also represent a constituency which I think is one of the kind of the most vibrant, most successful secondary high streets in Edinburgh, if not Scotland, in terms of what we have in Morningside and Brunsfield. And this Saturday, I'm really looking forward to a visit to Toys Galore and Cafe Zelig. I might nip into Edinburgh Bookshop. And of course, it being South Edinburgh, I will have to go into Nordic Living. I'm sure members would expect no less. And in case I'm not name-checking enough, in previous years, I've visited O Ruby Shoes, who are a wonderful retailer for gifts of all types. And I might even suggest that people nip into Houseproud if they need to pick up one or two items for their Christmas Day cooking requirements. Now, I make these name checks because I do want to, I think, really emphasise how important it is that we use our local businesses, especially at this time of year. And I think, as Michelle Thompson rightly pointed out, I think we all became, I think, very clear about how important these sorts of businesses in our local communities are as local glue. They are the businesses that very much kept the wheels on the wagon, that kept us all fed and indeed allowed us to sustain ourselves through lockdown. That's how important they are. Be very happy to.
Fergus Ewing.
I agree with what Mr Johnson has just said and respect his experience in running his own business, as indeed I did, albeit in a different century from that which Mr Johnson. But there an end. Could I ask if Mr Johnson agrees with me that one of the success stories of devolution, which we should all be proud of, and which has been maintained in the most recent emergency budget by John Swinney, is the protection of the Small Business Bonus Scheme, because it is the most generous scheme in the UK, for small businesses in particular, and it takes over 111,000 businesses out of rates altogether, and that really has been a help to address the financial pressures in COVID and in the recession.
Daniel Johnson, I'll give you the time back.
I'm very grateful, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm grateful to the member for making the point, although he's upsetting the order of my notes. So let me just briefly say, we do need to recognise that retail really depends on Christmas trade, and I think especially when times are so challenging. So if we think that those businesses are valuable, we have to use them at this time of year. But coming to the point, I was actually going to come to this, because I think the member's absolutely right. The Small Business Bonus Scheme is absolutely critical for many small businesses. But I think what I would say, I think we need to look at this actually more broadly in the round, because I think we are, as Michelle Thompson pointed out, in the middle of a cost of business crisis. Businesses are facing costs on a number of fronts that actually really question and undermine their viability. And I think on the one hand, I've spoken to local businesses who are seeing their utilities bills and the help from the UK government is of some help, but their deals will miss it. Their deals come up in the spring, and they're facing 7-8-fold increases, taking utilities bills going from £10,000 to over £100,000. No business can survive that. But likewise, on rates, and I'm glad the member brought it up, There are many businesses now whose rates bills exceed their rent. Now, on the basis of the way that rates are meant to work, with the poundage rate and RV, that should never be possible. And I'd also sort of note there are issues with the small business bonus scheme. The moment you have more than three premises, you lose it. So I think we need to have a look at rates in the round. I think we need to look at actually business costs in the round, because I think that there are a number of these things which I think really do jeopardise the viability of businesses. And likewise, I would just note, I think the points raised both about planning from Paul McLennan, and I think also what can we do to really ensure that, because there's a number of schemes to help small businesses take up technology, but I think we all have to acknowledge that they've not necessarily worked quite as much, and I think we need to keep thinking about what prevents small businesses from really maximising the use of technology. But in conclusion, you know, small businesses are at the very heart of our communities. They're really vital to bring in kind of distinctive characteristics of many of the communities that we represent. And if we value them, let's use them. Let's spend our money this Christmas time in local businesses on our local high streets. Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Mr. Johnson. I now call Christine Graham to be followed by Ariane Burgess. Around 4 minutes, Ms. Graham.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. Firstly, I congratulate my colleague on securing this timely debate. There can be no better time to focus on local shops and shopping than in the run-up to Christmas, though, of course, I must not omit trades and professions. Refurbishing my Gal office, I've used as many local trades as I can. Small businesses also, of course, includes local pubs and hotels. Many of these small businesses are family-owned, often over the generations, so both businesses and the owners are embedded and committed to their communities. There are many great small businesses across Midlothian, South Tweeddale and Lauderdale, from the main streets of Lauder, Earlston, the town centres of Melrose and Galla Shields, the High Street of Peebles, Pennycook Precinct, to the villages of Broughton and Oxton, with their community shops, which I'm pleased to say are doing well. I visited both, and community support is especially important there. I am additionally a shopper. This jacket, just happened to have it on, by the way, didn't mean it was a prop. Made in the Borders, bought in Peebles. For the avoidance of doubt, I am not the Jamie Halker-Johnson on commission. All these businesses are key to the community they serve. All depend on local patronage, and they are accessible year-round when rural roads may be unpassable. And of course, there's limited public transport. COVID was tough on all these small businesses, but especially retail and hospitality. COVID restrictions, movement curtailed, and folks stuck indoors and ordering from the supermarkets and the likes of Amazon online. Shopping habits have changed and have remained to some extent changed to this day. They were coming back into their own, these small businesses, but now they have yet another double whammy mentioned before, the cost of living and the energy crisis. Now, the Scottish Government has helped with its small business bonus scheme, I referenced Fergus Ewing, which means many local businesses pay no rates whatsoever. In Borders, and these are the recent figures this year, 5,820 get relief, of which 5,600 pay no business rates whatsoever. And in Midlothian, the figures are 1,220 with some relief and 1,130 100% relief, no rates whatsoever. But I accept some of the comments made by Daniel Johnson with his expertise. But the pressure on family budgets has meant many are cutting back as Christmas approaches. Some finding the choice is between heating and eating, and the rest is simply not on the agenda. Then there's the cost of energy to businesses themselves. I've had local businesses, particularly cafes, which now have sky-high energy costs and simply will not be able to stay open. The UK has, of course, the Energy Business Relief Scheme, which automatically caps the cost of unit per non-domestic energy, but you needn't apply, this is automatic. However, this ends in March 2023. So the First Minister has written to Rishi Sunak asking that something be put in its place for those businesses still in need. The First Minister also requested an enhanced windfall tax, which would raise £93 billion, which could be applied to assist with energy bills, both domestic and non-domestic. The Deputy First Minister also wrote to the then very, very temporary Chancellor, Kwasi Kwarteng, for VAT, mostly at 20% on non-domestic bills, to be reduced. Replies are awaited. In Scotland, there are schemes with grants to assist small businesses. If they have not already done so, they should check out Business Energy Scotland website and see what there is there. May not be appropriate, but at least check it out. In conclusion, against the background of inflationary pressures on domestic budgets, the additional costs on local business, then it's the time for us to do our bit, no matter how little, to support our local businesses. Shopping locally keeps the pennies and pounds local. It also leads to having a wee rest for weary feet with your parcels in the local cafe or pub. Yes, they need us, but we need them. Our town and village centres need them too. We must not take them for granted. So shop local if you can afford to. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Graham. I now call Ariane Burgess to be followed by John Mason. Around 4 minutes, Ms. Burgess.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I'd like to take a moment to thank Michelle Thompson for securing this important debate. The region I represent, Scotland's Highlands and Islands, are home to less than 10% of the country's population, but account for 22% of its social enterprises, many of which are thriving small businesses with a simple aim: to keep wealth generated by the community within the community. Many of the people supporting Small Business Saturdays this weekend may well shop at or receive the services of a social enterprise, but not realise that that's how they're set up. Presiding Officer, I was honoured to host Social Enterprise Scotland's Awards at the Parliament earlier this month. It was a fantastic celebration of the many social enterprises across Scotland working to enhance the lives of individuals, families, our communities and our environment through building community wealth. The sector contributes £2.3 billion to the economy and supports 88,000 jobs while giving us all the opportunity to play our part in building community wealth. These innovative businesses not only have a specific social or environmental mission, but crucially for rural communities, reinvest their profits in the businesses and local economy. These businesses are more likely to employ, buy and invest locally so that the wealth created through their business activity stays circulating in the local economy. Presiding Officer, to mark Small Business Saturday, I'd welcome the opportunity to mention just three of the incredible small social enterprises in the Highlands and Islands. Newstar Highland provides a range of services including housing support, employability training, furniture provision and mentoring to help people get back on their feet. In Shetland, the Creative Visual Arts Workshop GADA is an artist-led community interest company. Their core activity involves sharing specialist art facilities and skills with Shetland's diverse communities through their Borough Isle workshop. And in Inverness, Velocity Cafe and Bicycle Workshop is a social enterprise that combines three worlds: vegetarian cafe, bicycle workshop, and a range of projects to promote health, well-being and sustainability. Presiding Officer, as we've heard from across the chamber today, all small businesses and especially social enterprises are facing real challenges at the moment: rising energy costs, inflationary prices for essential raw materials and difficulty recruiting staff are issues repeatedly highlighted to me by constituents. I was contacted by a small bakery in Fort William for whom the price of sugar is increasing to 128%. This, coupled with staff shortages, has meant the business has reached a crisis point. These external threats to small businesses are having a disproportionate impact in remote rural communities, where small and medium-sized enterprises account for 79.5% of private sector employment. The local authority with the biggest fall in the number of registered businesses pre-pandemic was the Highlands, despite it, along with Shetland, Orkney and the Western Isles, being among the top five local authorities in terms of business density. This should concern us all. The Highlands and Islands Enterprise Business Panel this summer showed that fewer than half the businesses in our region had confidence in the economic outlook for Scotland, with exports tumbling and almost all impacted by rising costs, especially in remote areas. There is support out there, whether through organisations like Enterprise Agencies, Business Gateway and Social Enterprise Scotland, or through the government's plans outlined in the Bute House Agreement to develop procurement practices to support local economies and micro-businesses. Yet the support every small business most wants is that of customers, and I urge any constituents planning some festive shopping this weekend to make the most of the small businesses and social enterprises that bring vibrancy, bustle and life to their local high street.
Thank you very much indeed, Ms Murgess. I now call John Mason. Again, around 4 minutes, Mr Mason.
Thank you very much, and thank you to Michelle Thompson for bringing this debate on what I think is a really important topic. When I was younger, it was pretty well all small shops. I used to get sent for the messages, and the butcher minced the beef, as you watched, with the carcasses of the cows and the pigs and the sheep hanging all round the shop. And I think it was Cochrane's that was the largest shop in our area, until it was superseded by a Safeway supermarket, which seemed huge at the time, but nowadays would be seen as tiny compared to the big superstores that we have got used to. Is all of that progress? I am not sure. Shopping is now easier, quicker, certainly, as you go around, choose your own products, rather than having to ask for things one at a time. I confess that for much of the year, I do use supermarkets a lot. It is easy and convenient, especially if you're busy, to jump into a supermarket and buy a range of goods, including alcohol, as long as you're in and out by 10 p.m. But maybe this is one of the reasons that we have more problems today with isolation and loneliness. Going into a smaller shop, or a bank or a post office for that matter, has traditionally been a chance for folk to socialise and get a chat. Maybe we just have to accept that now we have a mix of the very large as well as smaller stores, not to mention online shopping. And of course, online, as has been mentioned, can involve smaller businesses too. But we do not want to lose all of our smaller physical shops. So I think having a day like Saturday to remind us of the importance of both small shops and other small businesses is very important. I've tended to try and visit small businesses each year, usually meaning shops, as they are open on Saturdays. This year I put it on Facebook and asked constituents for suggestions in case there were some small businesses I was not aware of. One person suggested there were 20 hairdressers in Shettleston itself, not counting the rest of the constituency. However, I don't think my remaining hair could handle being cut 20 times in the one day. But we do have some excellent butchers, bakers, coffee shops, and I will be aiming to visit some of them. However, it did strike me that we have very few fruiterers left in the East End of Glasgow. One I have used in the past for fruit and veg in Shettleston is now no longer there. But more positively, I think we're seeing an increase in independent bakers, as well as Polish, African and other shops, reflecting Glasgow's much more mixed population nowadays. And sometimes it can be hard to draw the line between what is a small business and what is not. For example, Costa and McDonald's are huge chains, but as they often operate on a franchise model, the people operating the particular branch may actually be a small business. I had tweeted something about a local Costa, and the next time I was in, the manager came over for a chat and was explaining how they really are a small business. And he also gave me a free cake. Just finally, to mention small businesses apart from shops and cafes, I guess there are positives as well as negatives. Yes,
to give Daniel Johnson.
Grateful to the member for going. He does realise the point of his Saturday is not to get free stuff, but to actually pay for stuff. I just want to confirm that.
John Mason.
Yes, I heartily endorse that. But if he wants to take me out for a coffee, I could be persuaded. So I guess there's positives as well as negatives. For example, in my constituency, we no longer have any local newspapers at all, and that is a disadvantage in many ways. However, we do have a local magazine now called The Hoolet, which carries local adverts and supports the use of Glasgow and Scots words as a sideline. So times change. We should not hanker for the past, and we should welcome local initiatives and new businesses. To end with a question, or a couple of questions, do we think enough about how we shop? Of course, some of us are forced to buy the cheapest item, but others of us can ask ourselves questions like, is this produce fair trade so the workers get decent pay and conditions? Is this food supporting farming jobs in Scotland? Am I shopping in a way that supports local small businesses? Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed, Mr Mason. I now invite the Minister to respond to the debate for around 7 minutes, Minister.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And can I begin by thanking Michelle Thompson for bringing this important debate to Parliament. It is always a highlight of the parliamentary calendar to celebrate Small Business Saturday, as it gives us that opportunity to come together and recognise the immense contribution that small businesses make, not just to our local and regional economies, but cumulatively to our national economy across Scotland, and the vital role to play. And it also does afford us an opportunity to recognise those individual businesses within our own constituencies and regions and the contribution that they make. One of the things that Michelle Thompson touched upon, I thought very effectively, was the social impact that small businesses have. Because while we can recognise that in certain commercial interactions that we process in our daily life, they can perhaps be somewhat impersonal. But within the context of small businesses, we often establish very close relationships with the people we work at, whether that be the cafe, the pub, the butchers, the picture framers, whatever it happens to be in a local high street. We often form personal relationships with those individuals, and it's not just a transactional relationship, but it's someone who is a fellow member of our community and indeed a friend. So that social impact is important, but it's also important in tackling a range of other issues, including for many people perhaps who are more at risk of loneliness or isolation. That interaction is important, and no more did we see the huge social impact that our small businesses have during the pandemic, something that members from across the Chamber have recognised. I do not think it is any exaggeration to say that many of our communities would not have been able to get through the pandemic in the way in which they did without the support of our small businesses. So I would want to join colleagues from across the Chamber in recognising the immense contribution that our small businesses make, not just to our local economies, but in the social impacts they have as well. Of course, we as has been touched on by many members, we are... Yeah, I'll be certainly...
Christine Graham.
You bring me to mind the fact that when I was told this story in London once, that when someone did not call at the local shop for a few days, the shopkeeper went to find out if they were all right, because they knew there was something very wrong, elderly or infirm person. So that's another example of how important they are in the social system for a community.
Minister.
I agree. I think that is an excellent example. And I think there's a particular example of our local pubs, the small businesses, and the impact that they have with their digital footprint as well in providing support to people. So it's an incredibly important point that Christine Graham has made. Of course, we cannot have this debate and ignore the significant economic challenges that not just small businesses but our wider economy faces. We are, I think, for many of us, seeing the most challenging set of economic circumstances in our lifetime. So it is absolutely imperative that we do all we can to support businesses through that. I recognise the comments that have been made in the Chamber both by Fergus Ewing and Daniel Johnson with regards to the Small Business Bonus Scheme, which I know is of immense support and is hugely valued by small businesses, and indeed has the power and impact of the Small Business Bonus Scheme is articulated very effectively by the likes of FSB. Certainly.
Fergus Ewing.
I entirely agree that we must be mindful of current challenges facing small businesses, and there an end. Is the Minister aware of concerns, I know it's not his portfolio, that the impacts of the deposit return scheme, as it is planned to be rolled out, would impact pretty severely on certain small businesses, notably small craft brewers and distillers, because of the high upfront costs, the burden of labelling, and that many of these very small businesses who we've championed over the years have actually said they may have to give up or even stop, and if they don't give up, stop trading in Scotland, which would, if it ever came to pass, which I hope not, would really be very, very deleterious. So is this something that you might wish to discuss with Lorna Slater, who I think is the Minister in charge?
Minister.
Can I thank Mr. Ewing for his intervention? And we want to assure him I have had these discussions directly with my ministerial colleague, Lorna Slater. I have also spoken about this in detail with the Scottish Retail Consortium and indeed the Scottish Grocers Federation. And I'm assured that Ms. Slater is having the closest engagement and consultation with stakeholders to ensure that when DRS is launched, it is done so in a way that we can recognise and celebrate for the positive impacts it will have on our net zero and waste reduction ambitions, and that it is something that we can ensure and work towards achieving the strongest buy-in and support from industry, remembering that this will be an industry-led scheme. Presiding Officer, I made reference to, was conscious of the challenges. Michelle Thompson also touched on some of the more long-standing challenges that businesses face. One, of course, is cash flow and late payment. I appreciate that it can be challenging to keep track of all the legislation going through Parliament, but I would draw members' attention to the Movable Transactions Bill, currently under consideration by the DPLR committee, and with the intention that it will shortly be considered by the Parliament as a whole at stage one. This is a bill, a product of the Scottish Law Commission, which I am leading on, but it is a bill that has the potential to make a powerful and transformational impact for small businesses, particularly around being able to facilitate invoice financing, where the current legal structures in Scotland are certainly not optimal to doing that, as well as allowing for securities to be achieved over movable corporeal and indeed incorporeal property, something that will be of much benefit to the wider Scottish economy. And I look forward to further engagement with members on that legislation as it progresses through Parliament. There was a range of comments from members covering many different areas that I do not think I will have the opportunity to cover in detail, but I would want to go and pick up any important points that Ariane Burgess raised around social enterprises and indeed community wealth building. Social enterprises play a key role in our local economies, as we would understand, is inherent within their model. They reinvest their monies back into their local communities very effectively and play a key role in delivering a range of services, and they are a fantastic example of community wealth building. But so are our more traditional small businesses. I met earlier this year with the Federation of Small Businesses to discuss community wealth building. I know this is something that they are passionately interested in. Indeed, there is FSB representation on the Community Wealth Building Bill Steering Group that I chair. Community wealth building is something that we'll have a great deal more to say about in the new year as we take forward our commitment to a consultation ahead of legislation later in this parliamentary session. But at its heart, community wealth building is about seeing more wealth that is generated within our communities, retained within our communities. And that has many practical applications, such as making more effective use of sustainable procurement, employment practices that recruit from our localities, and indeed seeing more business models develop which are consistent with small businesses, but whether that be employee-owned co-ops, community interest companies, or indeed social enterprises, which can cumulatively help to go and create more sustainable and resilient local economies, which will be the bedrock for continued success for all our small businesses across Scotland. President Officer, I am conscious that time is against me, so let me just conclude by once again thanking members for their contribution in this debate this afternoon, and indeed to wish everyone a very successful Small Business Saturday.
Thank you very much indeed, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I suspend this meeting of Parliament until 2:30.